Thank you so much. Thank you, Josh. And I praise God for, again, our worship team. I say it often. I praise God for our kids' ministry environments, for our guest services, people pouring in and giving so much. And I thank God you're here this morning. We're going to be in Isaiah chapter 6 this morning. Isaiah 6, so if you have your Bibles, you can turn there. It'll also be on screen. Again, we use the Greenbrier Church app. Our outline is up there. There's a video cast and a podcast up there each week. If you want to follow along, you miss it, the outline, the notes, the verses are all listed there. I'm so thankful you're here, of all places you could be. We are doing just kind of a micro series of sorts, just last week and this week, talking in essence about God make us is the overall theme. God make us. And this week is visionary, but when we go with the effort of saying God make us, nobody here, if we're honest, likes to be made to do anything, do we? As kids, how many of you, let's be honest, how many of you even remember a time where you were made to take a bath? So y'all all just took it voluntarily? Or you're a bunch of liars, all right? How made to brush your teeth. Does anybody remember that? Made to brush your teeth. Okay, thank you. Made to eat peas, all right? That's like the most ridiculous. Peas, liver, and onions. Anybody else here had to suffer through eating? Thank you very much, at least. So that was, again, we all kind of have pushback with certain things. Some of you are like, oh, I love liver and onions. Oh, yeah, you're in the world all by yourself. No, again, I know we know some people like it, and that's cool. But with this, we all, there's an element of pushback with every one of us in having to be made to do something. But if we're honest, if we think about it, when our parents sometimes made us do something, it was for our good, even though we didn't, and we needed that to happen. You need to do your homework. What if I don't want to? That's fine. Can you learn to say the phrase, would you like fries with that? All right? I mean, it's, in essence, it's kind of that expression of, you know, we have to be made to do things. Otherwise, we're setting a standard for ourselves. We're lowering it. If even more spiritually, if we want to experience the power of God, we need God's intervention in our life. We need for God's strength, his help to make us do some things sometimes that don't come naturally. Let's look at this passage and just kind of digging right in with Isaiah chapter 6, a passage that some of you have definitely heard before, but let's dig in. In the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. And it starts off again, in the year King Uzziah died, this was 740 BC, this marked Isaiah because there was a connection, there was a closeness, this marked his ministry, and it basically marked time. We know when King Uzziah died, but to Isaiah, this was huge. And so already there was something, there was a huge traumatic event in his life. And isn't it crazy, if we're honest, isn't it wild that for some of us, I don't know about you, but sometimes it takes a traumatic crisis in our life for God to get our attention. Not all of us run to God on a daily basis. And in fact, I'll go as far to say as this, the hardest time in a walk with Christ, to walk with God, is during calm waters. Because everything's going good. Everything's smooth. We can just kind of do our own thing and everything's good. But then all of a sudden, crisis, it's kind of like thunder when you're a child. Where do you run? Mom, Dad. And we run, whenever there's a crisis, whenever there's thunder in our world, we run to our parents. Whenever there's crisis in our world spiritually, there's a tendency to run to God, whereas we might not otherwise. But in this, he's recognizing God. I saw the Lord seated high on a throne, high and exalted. The train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphs, each with six wings. With two, they covered their faces. With two, they covered their feet. With two, they were flying, and they were calling to one another. Hold, I'm going to stop right there. I'm sorry, today is not going to be expositional preachers on the seraphim and what their wings represented and everything else. I would love to be able to dig into that, but that'll take, anyway, but that's a whole nother thing. So we're going to actually be skipping over that. So if any of you are expecting to dig back in that, all right, we're moving on. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. And that is, again, I believe that's almost a drawback to saying these were imaginable creatures. These are something beyond belief, and their purpose was to call glory to God. That's why they were there. We can dig into what they were and why they did, but their purpose in this whole story is to recognize, however amazing they were, their purpose was to draw glory to God and call out his holiness. At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried. "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Let's just kind of put this in context. What Isaiah is saying at that moment is, "Holy seraphim, Batman, I see God." I mean, this was just like beyond belief. It was customary. Let's go ahead and put it out there. It was customary in this day and time, if you saw God, you die. I mean, whether you wanted to or not, it's like, "I see God. Okay, I'm going to die now." You did not see God without there being consequence. And so this was huge. He looked at God and he's just like, I'm ruined. I saw God. I'm going to die here because I see how, compared to him, how sinful and messed up I am. Anyway, and he goes on, "I see the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphs flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and he said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I. Send me." And he said, "Go tell this people, be ever hearing, never understanding, be ever seeing, never perceiving." And with this, he was just immediately stepping into the presence of God. And for many of us, it's just this realization. We've got to step in to grasping what Isaiah did. He was before God and he recognized, I'm completely unclean. I don't deserve to be in God's glory. And if we're sitting here and if we recognize who we are before God, if we really place ourselves before the throne of God, we're going to recognize we don't even deserve to hear his voice. But yet he gives us his word. He speaks to us through prayer. The Holy Spirit imparts wisdom and discernment to us because he wants us to know his presence. This morning, to dive in just where we're going with this, just a very simple outline, looking at it, for God to make us visionary, for us to experience his power, for us to experience his presence, for God to make us visionary, these are some things I must do. First, I must acknowledge who I am in God's presence. I must acknowledge who I am in God's presence. This is what Isaiah did, but in this, wouldn't you agree that when we keep our distance from God, when we hold the church at bay, when we don't place ourselves in spiritual environments, it's a whole heck of a lot easier to navigate our guilt. In the truth, we can kind of push off church, we can push off a spiritual experience, we don't immerse ourselves in Bible study, we don't have a God time, it's a lot easier to not feel guilty about our sin. It's a lot easier to walk in sin. It's a lot easier to take steps avoiding it when we avoid those environments. But if we place ourselves in a spiritual environment, we place ourselves, man, we're singing God songs about God's glory, and we're laying it out, just stripped down our worship today, just even acoustic guitar, we're just talking about how amazing God is. It's hard to sing that song with your heart and not recognize there's a holy God and not deal with conviction of sin in our life. So it's a lot easier to push ourselves aside. It's kind of like when I remember being out taking a youth mission trip, and on the way back, we stopped in, I think it was in St. Louis, and happened to have a street preacher out on the corner, and he was standing on a box, and he was hollering at, "Sinners! Sinners!" And I'm like, I get the point. And went over and tried to talk to him and said, "Hey, listen, man, I don't know. It's one of those random things." I went up to talk to the guy and normally would not go up and confront. I wasn't going to confront. I was going to encourage him. I wanted him to know, man, I'm praying for him because I know it must be hard trying to tell people about Jesus. And he turned on me, "You're a sinner. You're a dude." And I'm like, "I know I am, man, but I love Jesus, all right?" And he started pointing at other people, "You're a sinner." And I'm like, okay, I don't feel any guilt or conviction here. I just feel like you're a fool right now. But anyway, it was one of those weird moments. Again, we can be in those, and it's easy to brush aside when we see some televangelist that isn't living for Jesus. He's living for you to basically fund his ministry so he can, anyway, that's a whole other thing going on right now. But you can fly around the world, and that's a whole other ball game. Right now, when we're drawn into God's presence, there's something about being in his presence that convicts if we're willing to listen. And with that, again, we've got to acknowledge who his presence is and move on from there. It's not staying there. You know, it's this thing of when God is speaking in our life, we can see sin surfacing. And in fact, with this passage, looking at verses 5-7, basically what he says is this: "Woe to me, I'm ruined, I'm a man of unclean lips. I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." He recognized, I'm messed up. I've got to recognize who I am before God. And if you and I want to see God's vision, experience the power of God in our life, we've got to ask God, God, make me visionary. God, please help me to recognize who you are and who I am when I'm in front of you. Well, basically, it's this thing of in our situation here, we can be in this little concealed world, and we can kind of put a bubble around ourselves and not experience the power of God, or we can step up to it and realize he has overcome. Isn't it crazy that we feel, for many of us, we feel like we've got to come to church perfect? I wonder how many of us feel like when we walk in the doors, we have to conceal our sin. We have to hold back our junk. Isn't it crazy that the place that we should be most vulnerable on this planet is in the body of Christ? Because we recognize together that Jesus Christ has overcome our sin. He's forgiven us of our sin. But yet, for many of us, our MO is that we come to church and feel like we've got to put on a facade. I hate that. I hate that for us. At Greenbrier Church, it shouldn't be that way. In fact, I believe for the most part, we pretty much have a philosophy of, hey, I'm messed up, you are too, welcome to Greenbrier. I mean, it's kind of, we want you to know we're messed up together. But we kind of have that tendency, all have that tendency to do in one form or another, driving to church, yo, shut up, we're going to go worship Jesus. Okay, da, 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 da. And we get on to church and then, hey, how are you doing this morning? You know, and the kids go to grab donuts and like, I'm going to kill you after church. Hey, good to see you. And it, you know, it's that thing of we do this, we have this drill, we put on the act where this is the place we should be most vulnerable. But what I find, and this is over and over again, I see this, we should acknowledge again that we're in God's presence. We need to confess it. Are we sinners? Yes. Every one of us are sinners. Confess it. Deal with it. Get over it. Get over yourself. If God can't overcome your sin, then you have an extremely small God, and it's not the same one I'm worshiping. But God is a God who loves us. And here's something I've discovered, you know, just over and over again. Our past sin isn't to define us, but it's to remind us of God's grace. But here's the crazy thing I've seen continually in my world. The most purposeless and unforgiving people that I know in the world, and here's what I've experienced. They're not willing to embrace their own sin. The most purposeless and unforgiving people in the world are not willing to embrace their own sin. And as a result of that, they cannot embrace the grace of Jesus Christ. There's no way that you and I can embrace the power and the fullness of Jesus Christ's grace poured on us if we can't embrace the fact I'm a sinner. If we can't see who we are before a holy God, then basically our sin is really nothing. It's minuscule. Does that make sense? If we don't recognize how wretched we are, I love sinners in the hands of an angry God, Jonathan Edwards, it's laying out again that we are wretched and we're standing before a holy and righteous God. If we can't grasp how sinful we are, then we have no need for grace and mercy. And those people that cannot grasp it are usually the most purposeless and the most unforgiving people because we don't know what grace is. We're not willing to receive it from God. So let me lead on the second. The first one is acknowledge who I am in God's presence if we want to experience God and basically being a visionary God. The second is this, to know God will complete his vision. To know God will complete his vision. In this passage, basically we see in verse 8, as it pulls up very simply, it says this, "Then I heard a voice from the Lord saying, 'Who shall I send and who will go for us?' He said, 'Here am I, send me.'" What God is doing is this. He's basically like, who will I send? Who will go for us? Bueller. He's waiting for a response. If he's not looking at, basically it's like we have done with our daughters. Our daughters sometimes just, I don't know, kind of crazy. We'll be talking and like we'll have a conversation going and just naturally, one of our daughters will like raise their hand. This has happened. I don't know if it's happened in your home. It's kind of like, okay, you're the only other person here. Anyone else? Okay, you. And it's kind of that thing of he's standing right there before God, and God's going, who's going to go for us? Who will I send? And Isaiah's like, I'm the only one here. Isaiah had to make a choice. He's giving Isaiah the option, and Isaiah is standing there, even though the seraphim and basically all the other creatures before God, God's saying, who's going to go for me? I'm not going to make you. God's not going to make you obey him. He's not going to make me obey him. And sometimes I don't like that. We're not called to be robots. God doesn't do that. I know in our house, if we ask our children to do something, we want it done. And God, in the same way, he wants it done, but he is giving you the option. You can obey or not. It's your choice. And if you obey, you're stepping into my will. If you're not, you're not in my will. You're not walking in the path that I'm basically laying out for you. You're not stepping into the plan I have for you. Basically, this thing is God finishes what he started. God's going to get it done. It is not like if you had, so let's say, just like an antique table at your home that's been sitting in your garage like for 8 years unfinished. That's just an illustration, not personal, all right? It's not like one of those unfinished projects you might have at your home that your wife's been asking you to do for 2 months, 6 months. The wife's going 2 years, you know, whatever else. It's not like those unfinished things. What God does is he lays out, he's going to finish his projects. He's not going to make you do it. He's not going to make me do it. And sometimes I want God, just, I don't know what it is, make me do what's going to glorify you. But with that, we have to know that God is going to complete what he started. He's going to finish what he started. That's who he is. And again, that was just an illustration about the table, not personal at all. Everything God does is about drawing glory to himself. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whoever believes in him will not perish. It's all about drawing God glory. That's his purpose. That's his end game. God is not concealing anything. He's not holding anything back. He wants you to know, my purpose is to draw glory to myself. You want to be a part of my plan? It's going to be drawing glory to myself. It's not living on your agenda. I am not subjecting myself to you to say, do you approve? Because this is my agenda. Do you want to be a part of it or not? Even God, what he says in 2 Peter 3:9, he's not slow in keeping his promises. He wants to redeem everyone. He desires that none would perish, that all would turn to him. So God is again laying it out there, and he will complete his vision. He just gives us a part of this thing of stepping into it. He's not moving aimlessly. God is not just kind of randomly doing things, not thinking about what he's doing. Kind of like when I came up here Thursday to the school, I was driving down Riverwood Parkway and passing the road, Generalwood Parkway dead ends. I mean, it has a stop sign right there and to go across. And I'm driving through the intersection coming up to the middle school on Thursday morning, and literally going through the intersection, all of a sudden peripheral vision said, something's wrong here. And there was a black SUV that had been sitting at the stop sign. And as I'm driving through, they decided, okay, now's the time to go. And they drove through. And I slammed on the brakes. And I don't normally do this. Slammed on the brakes and I hit the horn. And I literally skidded sideways to where that car had to have been within at least a foot of me. And here's the crazy thing. I'm holding on to the horn. I'm seeing the car slide sideways like, I'm a stunt driver. Cool. Anyway, but here's the bad thing for me. I knew that in my Honda that if I got hit with the insurance I have, it would be totaled and we would not have a car. I mean, I wouldn't get anything for the thing. I'd be like, well, here's $50. You know, have a good, you know, good day. But it's like I knew my car would have been totaled because this car, the way it pulled out, slid sideways and the car just kept going, da-da-da-da-da. All I can figure is they were texting or whatever, which again, July, again, it's not going to be a matter of just knowing. It's not going to be a matter of, oh, do I have the option of texting and drive? No, all right? Coming in July 1st, is it? Okay, anyway, you can't text, drive, can't talk in your phone, drive, it has to be wireless. But anyway, so that's again going to be another illustration of law enforcement in Georgia make us not use our phones, all right? So, but with that, I don't know, that came out of the blue. So, sorry, ADD, bird, squirrel. With that, the whole thing of, I'm just like, this person was so aimless in where they're driving. And to me, what bothered me more than anything was they just kind of kept on, da, 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 going on down. I'm like, look, I just had my $50 car avoid hitting your $30,000 car, and you're just going to keep humming on down the road, heading toward Champions Retreat or wherever you live. And I'm like, I just saved your day. And then my cars, all of a sudden, I could see a little bit of smoke, a puff of smoke coming from each of the tires. And I was like, great. Now I just lost tread on my tires, too. Anyway, so it came on up. But God, again, the crazy thing about it, now some of y'all are probably poking, that was you, wasn't it? Anyway, so if you have a black SUV, it could have been you. But anyway, that said, God is not aimless in what he does. He's very intentional. He knows where he's going, and he has a purpose in taking us there. And it's one of the crazy things that, again, all sorts of stories. I love when we look at the vision of God. I love doing things that are random, that are not normal. I've said from the beginning, for Greenbrier Church, if it means to reach souls for Christ, if it means us meeting in a bar, we'll do it. If it means us meeting wherever, we'll do it. We just want to see people come to Jesus and sell out their lives to it. I loved when we moved to the movie theater and years back, and we had our, you know, we did services there. It killed us as a team setting up and breaking down because it was so much work. But our team was amazing in all they did. But one of my favorite Sundays was early in June in 2009. And the reason it was one of my favorites is because I had had people recently, actually before we even moved in, said we really shouldn't move in the theater because they show movies in there that are not honoring to God. I'm like, well, it's a public movie theater. They're not going to honor God intentionally. You know, if it's a Christian movie theater, it's a whole nother story. And then I was told, well, we need to cover up the posters because they might be offensive. And I'm like, listen, it's incredible that we're stepping into a place where culture comes and they pay money to come here. And we're coming in and we're sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. But the ultimate, after I'd had actually several discussions within the prior weeks to that, that Sunday we walked in, and here were the movie listings. As you're walking down the hallway to 3D and Briar Patch, it was this. In one theater that our elementary age kids was Angels and Demons. That was the marquee outside that theater. On our baby room, where our babies were kept, babies were out in the hallway, but on the theater on one side, the movie there was Drag You to Hell. And then where I think our threes and fours, actually the area they were in, was Land of the Lost. And I'm like, you know, you couldn't get more, this is the church. This is why we're here. But just symbolic, Drag You to Hell, Land of the Lost, and with, the Angels and Demons. And I'm like, okay, God, this is so good. I love it. And this is why we're doing what we're doing. And this is who we are as a church. God's vision is bigger than us. It's bigger than our problems. It's bigger than our situation. And it's why one of my favorite passages I share all the time, Isaiah 55:11. But let me give you a little background. Verse 10, pre-verse, says Isaiah 55:10, as the rain and snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes forth from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but it will accomplish that which I desire and achieve the purpose which I send it. Verse 13, this will be for the Lord's renown, for an everlasting sign which will not be destroyed. I quote this a lot because what I've come to believe is just the world may speak, it ain't going to happen. But God says, if I'm speaking it, it's happening. If you want to know, want to see me accomplish something amazing, just step into my will, because it doesn't matter what the world says. It really doesn't. Something can be completely contrary and it's not going to happen. The crazy thing about God is something's going to happen when he speaks. Something's going to grow. Something's going to change. God is not clueless. He's not sure what to do. He's very intentional to draw glory to himself. That's who God is. And he wants to draw glory to himself, just like with Isaiah. He says, who's going to go for us? Who's going to draw attention to me? He's drawing glory. We think of visionary people as people that build rocket ships, as people that start companies, as people that begin nonprofits that feed 10,000 people. But I believe the most visionary people are those people that realize they were created by God, for God, and for God's purposes. I believe that's the most visionary person you can have on the planet. Somebody that realizes, I'm created by God and I'm here for God's purposes. You want to know what purpose is? You don't know what vision is? It's step into that. You're here for a reason. You're breathing for a reason. Your sin doesn't define you. Your past doesn't define you. It's only there to remind you of God's grace, his mercy. And with that, his vision basically knows your past, yet he's intentionally chosen that for his future, his current and future glory, he wants to spend you. If God's speaking your heart and soul, do you recognize that? I struggle with that. I struggle with grasping this. God intentionally calls us to be a part of his current, his present, and future glory for his fame. In spite of the thing we've struggled with, in spite of our sin habit, in spite of this destruction that we caused, in spite of this element of failure we may feel, in spite of our emotions, in spite of any of that, God says, for my present, future glory, who will I send? Who will go for us? And I say that because this morning, if you hear the voice of the Holy Spirit speaking your heart and soul about something, it's not by accident. It's not just because you happen to be here. It's because God is saying, I want you to be a part of my purposes. So what are you going to do? Who am I going to send? I'm going to do it. Are you going to be a part of this? And I say this as one who struggles with this. I say it as one who I hear the voice of God, and I've seen past failures. I've seen things that have fallen down, and I'm like, God, I just feel like I can't get it right in this area. And God just keeps reminding me, I'm not making a mistake. It's a matter of you're going to step up. With that, this whole thing, for some of us, it's even in the realm of parenting. I believe that we can, no one else can parent your child the way you do. I look at Meg, Abby, and Laura, and I've always just kind of had this thought. Sometimes I think of it and just think of, man, praise God for the gift of my girls. And other times I'm thinking, God, why did you entrust them to me? Because I feel like I'm just going to mess up. But God says, I've chosen you. What are you going to do with this opportunity? What are you going to do with this privilege? Anyway, God is visionary, and we need him to make us visionary. God's vision for us is to bring him glory. And Isaiah 6 basically is saying, don't be fooled. He's going to accomplish it. But let me go on to the third element. We need to trust God's vision has no limits. Trust God's vision has no limits. He sees what can be done. And with that, though God could use somebody else, even though you feel like you're a failure, even though you feel like you're undone, even though you feel like you look at yourself and go, how can you use me? If those are the questions going through your mind, you're the perfect candidate. If those are the things going through your mind going, I've messed up so bad, that's what God wants, because he wants you to recognize that you're a sinner before him. You're messed up. And when we're open and that willing, that vulnerable before God, that's when God can take us. And with that, so this, I love just a few verses that God brought to heart is preparing and digging through. We may look at our finances and go, God, you can't use me. Philippians 4:19, for my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. I don't have the finances. God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. And you don't think he can do you? He can take you and spend you? Or God, you got to look at my age. Genesis 12:4. So Abram left as the Lord told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out for Haran. The beginning of everything, man. When he's 75 years old and he's just getting started. And God's going, I'm going to begin something new with you. I'm going to begin something new with you, and you're 75. No, we're not too old, so quit using that one. I use it too often. With this one, he's not limited by your past, and this is one of my all-time favorites. Psalm 51, 17, the sacrifices of God are broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. Oh God, you will not despise. He looked at David and his adulterous, murdering self. He said, I've still got a plan for you. You've blown it. But I haven't given up on you because I've got a plan. Are you going to join me? Anyone? Anyone? Bueller? David? David stepped in. So that's another one. And with it, again, he was not limited. God is not limited by our addictions. 1 Corinthians 10:13 says, no temptation has seized you except what is common to man. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you're tempted, he will also provide a way out so you can stand up under it. There's nothing limiting God working in your life and mine. The only thing that limits God spending us, two things. My involvement in God's vision, only things that limit it are one, sin. That I'm going to choose sin, basically choosing to disobey God, choosing to turn away from what God has told me is right, to embrace what is offensive. I'm going to basically choose that. That limits me because God's saying, I want to spend you. You're going to choose a temporary pleasure over an eternal glory. That's what you're choosing. We choose a temporary pleasure, something that's temporal. It's only going to be fulfilling, like eating Chinese food. It's going to be good at the moment, but 2 hours later, you're going to be searching the refrigerator for something else. Don't you know it? Maybe you're like, I don't like Chinese food. That's fine. I do. Go eat your liver and onions. Okay, anyway, so again, the involvement with God's vision is limited only by, number one, our sin. The second, and this is huge, this is even bigger, I believe, for most of us, which involves sin, is our heart, our obedience. What keeps us from being involved is stepping into being a part of God's visionary plan. For God to make us visionary, you and I have to make a choice. Our involvement in God's vision is limited by our sin, and by our heart, our obedience. A few verses I want you to grasp here. Isaiah 20, I'm giving you a lot of verses because I want you to hear God's word. Like I said, a key verse, Isaiah 55, 10 through 13, God's word's going to tell you something. And I believe some of you, you're not going to be able to leave here without hearing God's voice. But now you've got a choice to respond. Just like as I was preparing, just God convicting of so many things. Isaiah 29:13, you honor me with your lips, but your hearts are far from me. Our hearts are so significant. If we want to obey God, our heart has to be there. Just saying, God, I've prayed this before. God, right now, I don't desire you. Please give me a desire to desire you. I don't know if you've ever been that straightforward with God. God, I don't have anything in me that's just saying I want to spend time with you. Please give me a desire to spend time with you. Our hearts make a huge difference as to where we are with God. Joel 2:12 says, even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning. And for some of us, it's just taking that step back of confessing, God, I need you so desperately. I'm turning to you now. I need you, please, to call me back home. Proverbs 4:23, above all else, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. Proverbs 3:5 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight. God has a purpose and a plan, but it begins with our heart. And the big thing that all of us have to choose, we have to decide, is simply this. Are we going to allow God to spend us? Do we want God to spend us? Jeremiah 29:11 goes on to say this, and again, an amazing passage that some of us may have the whole passage memorized, but for others, I want to encourage you. God says this, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Then you will call upon me and pray, and I will listen, and you'll seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. It's incredible to step into a God that is visionary and realize you have a purpose. I loved it one Sunday when I had one of our crew, one of you, came up, and it was very humbling, but out of the blue, they offered this, shared this with me in just such a powerful way. Basically, they said, Chuck, I'm not going to ever get up in front of people and talk because I get tongue-tied and I really get nervous. I don't like getting up in front of people. He said, but I figure if I can set up chairs and if I can help like in the baby environment and if I can help basically just with us doing what we do on Sunday morning, then I'm being a part of our church sharing Jesus Christ with people. And I'm like, yes, I get it. That's vision. It's going, yeah, it's not about being up here, guys. I'm sharing this with you from what God is teaching me. But this isn't the gospel, just somebody standing up in front and teaching a group of people. The gospel is you and I getting out in the world that desperately needs Jesus. And Proverbs 24:11 says, rescue the perishing, hold back those that are staggering toward a slaughter. And you and I are doing that. Unless you and I do that, it's not going to happen. If you're waiting for me, for our staff to do it, it's not going to happen. It's our responsibility. There's a world that desperately needs Jesus. And if we're honest, some of us are even here this morning realizing, you know, it's easy to say all this, but in all honesty, there's not a lot of hope right now in my world. Maybe for some of us, we can't see the hope of tomorrow. And if we're going to be honest, it's just realizing that we have so little hope today. And so we're like, how can God use me in something tomorrow? God wants us to leave this place as visionary. God wants us to leave this place realizing that if I step into his purpose, he's going to spend me on purpose, with his purpose. That's what he did with Isaiah. That's what he did when he grabbed hold of Isaiah and he said, you know, who am I going to send? And Isaiah chose to respond in a way that God could use him. God is visionary. He wants to do more in your marriage than you want to. He wants to do more in your career than you want to. For his glory. He wants to do more in your education than you want to. I guarantee it. His vision for your life, for your marriage, for your career, for your children is much bigger than yours. I still am discovering that. Sometimes I have a hard time embracing it. But we have to choose, am I going to be one of God's vessels? Am I going to submit to God's vision, his purposes, his ways? One of my favorite authors, communicators from long ago, over 100 years ago, this was written, Oswald Chambers. Just a quote by him, and I love this guy. It says, if you'll give God your right to yourself, he will make a holy experiment out of you. And I love this. And his experiments always succeed. How powerful is that? We can bumble around trying to do it ourselves. We can. But we need God to make us visionary. God, what's your purpose? Because my purpose is limited. My purpose, I see basically this little fix I have, this habit, this thing I'm running to, this thing I'm avoiding. It has an end to it. But God's purpose is eternal. And he's inviting us to be a part of giving himself glory, just like he did Isaiah. Who will I send? Who will go for us? And Isaiah chose wisely. Here am I. Send me. We've got to make a choice. Are we going to let God spend us that way? Are we going to trust God? I'm going to leave you just with a couple of questions very quickly. It's this. What step do I need to take today to be obedient to God? What step? Is there a step? And with that, I'll even include this. That step may be a step of obedience away from sin. If God's convicted you of something, why? Why would we still walk in it? And I say that from one who's done it before, and you walk in it, you rationalize it away, and we can kind of, well, the preacher wasn't that good, and what he was saying really wasn't that true. This little thing, that really was applied to them back in Isaiah's day, and we can talk about things and kind of whittle them away, but when the Holy Spirit speaks, why would we want to turn away from that? Why would we not want to listen and be obedient? Even with that, again, the step toward to take, be obedient to God, know this, that any step of non-obedience, if we don't obey, that's disobedience. When God tells us to do something, and I've walked in this too many times, I'm holding off, I'm reluctant. Any step of non-obedience is disobedience. That's sin. So if God convicts us of something and we're not stepping into it, we've got to realize that's disobedience, that's sin. We can't draw glory to God. Don't we realize God is saying, I want you to be a part of my glory? I'm not doing this for your pain. I'm not inviting you to be a part of my purposes because I want to cause you pain. If I can just cause a misery, that's all I want to do. No, he wants us to be in his experience, his presence, and his power. That's why he does it. So the next question is, what am I attempting in my life that can only happen if God shows up? What am I attempting in my life? And this is one of the hardest things we do as a church. It's so easy to go through routine. But what are we stepping out to do? God doesn't show up, it's going to be a miserable fail. I want to be that kind of person. There are points in my life I can look back and see, oh man, we stepped out incredibly there. But it's too easy to live in a safe zone. Well, this is going to cost too much. What? If it's for God's glory, he's going to take care of it. My prayer is that, again, if there's anything you need to be obedient to, you'll obey. If there's any next step you need to take, you'll take it today. If there's any sin you need to confess, whether it's to God or to others, or maybe it's to both, you'll confess it. If there's something that God wants to do that if only God showed up in your life, it would fail. Why not do it? Why not risk it and see what God's going to do? Worst thing that can happen is people go, wow, at least they had faith. God's going to do it. We need to ask God to make us visionary, though, to trust him with those things that he's calling us to take, those steps he's calling us to take in our life. Let's pray. My Jesus, again, I praise you for your call in our life. I praise you that you speak to us out of truth, out of love. You call us to be a part of your glory, even though we don't deserve it. And I pray, God, this morning we would step up in faith. We'd quit with our battles of rationalizing away when, Holy Spirit, you're trying to call us to take a next step. You're convicting us of sin. You're leading us to a glory eternal. Please, God, forgive us. And ask, Holy Spirit, right now, you would speak to us in an undeniable way, each person in this room. You would point them to the exact next step they need to take, and you would give them strength to take it. I thank you, God, you don't make us obey you. You don't make us follow you. But I pray right now, God, you would, Holy Spirit, ignite us where we wouldn't choose anything but that. Please destroy the arguments Satan is giving some of us right now for following you, for obeying you, and help us to live that life that's amazing, experiencing your power. This morning as we pray, I just want to ask simply and first, if you've never surrendered your life to Christ, why not take that first step of asking Jesus Christ to be your Lord, to be your Savior? If that's your heart, your soul, will you, this moment, will you ask Christ to be your Lord? Paul laid it out in Romans 10. I share this all the time. He said, if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we'll be saved. If that's your heart, your soul this morning, will you simply pray with me that prayer in your own words? Dear Jesus, I recognize that I am sinful. I have habits and attitudes, decisions I'm making that do not honor you. God, please forgive me of my sin. And please cleanse me with the blood of Christ. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for me and rose again from the grave for me. And as much as I know how at this moment, I surrender to you as Lord and as Savior. Thank you for promising to save me and never leave me. With our heads bowed and with our eyes closed, if that was your decision this morning for the first time, will you simply raise your hand where you are? That was me for the first time this morning. I surrender to Christ. Thank you. For others, what is that next step God is leading you to take? Will you confess that before God now? That surrender of sin, that confession of sin, or a next step that you've been holding off on but you know God is calling you to take? Will you confess that to Jesus? God, please make us visionary. Please make us your holy experiment because I know they will succeed. Please give us strength and discernment to follow you, obey you, no matter what. We lift this up in the powerful name of our Savior, Christ. It's in your name we pray. Amen.